This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Mystery of 31 New Inn. Author: Richard Austin Freeman. Preface. Commenting upon one of my earlier novels, in respect of which I had claimed to have been careful to adhere to common probabilities and to have made use only of really practicable methods of investigation, a critic remarked that this was of no consequence whatever, so long as the story was amusing. Few people, I imagine, will agree with him. To most readers, and certainly to the kind of reader for whom an author is willing to take trouble, complete realism in respect of incidents and methods is an essential factor in maintaining the interest of a detective story. Hence, it may be worthwhile to mention that Thorndyke's method of producing the track chart, described in chapters 2 and 3, has been actually used in practice. It is a modification of one devised by me many years ago, when I was crossing Ashanti to the city of Bantuku, the whereabouts of which in the far interior was then only vaguely known. My instructions were to fix the positions of all towns, villages, rivers, and mountains as accurately as possible. But finding ordinary methods of surveying impracticable in the dense forest which covers the whole region, I adopted this simple and apparently rude method, checking the distances whenever possible by astronomical observation. The resulting route map was surprisingly accurate, as shown by the agreement of the outward and homeward tracks. It was published by the Royal Geographical Society and incorporated in the map of this region compiled by the intelligence branch of the War Office, and it formed the basis of the map which accompanied my volume of travels in Ashanti and Jamin. So that Thorndyke's plan must be taken as quite a practicable one. New Inn, the background of this story, and one of the last surviving inns of Chancery, has recently passed away after upwards of four centuries of newness. Even now, however, a few of the old dismantled houses, including perhaps the mysterious 31, may be seen from the Strand peeping over the iron roof of the skating rink, which has displaced the picturesque hall, the pension room, and the garden. The postern gate, too, in Houghton Street still remains, though the arch is bricked up inside. Passing it lately, I made the rough sketch which appears on next page, and which shows all that is left of this pleasant old London backwater. R.A.F. Gravesend. Chapter 1. The Mysterious Patient. As I look back through the years of my association with John Thorndyke, I am able to recall a wealth of adventures and strange experiences, such as falls to the lot of very few men who pass their lives within hearing of Big Ben. Many of these experiences I have already placed on record, but it now occurs to me that I have hitherto left unrecorded one that is, perhaps, the most astonishing and incredible of the whole series. An adventure, too, that has for me the added interest that it inaugurated my permanent association with my learned and talented friend, and marked the close of a rather unhappy and unprosperous period of my life. Memory, retracing the journey through the passing years to the starting point of those strange events, lands me in a shabby little ground floor room in a house near the Walworth end of Lower Kennington Lane. A couple of framed diplomas on the wall, a card of Snellen's test types, and a stethoscope lying on the writing table, proclaim it a doctor's consulting room, and my own position in the round back chair at the said table proclaims me the practitioner in charge. It was nearly 9 o'clock. The noisy little clock on the mantelpiece announced the fact, and by its frantic ticking, seemed as anxious as I to get the consultation hours over. I glanced wistfully at my mud-splashed boots, and wondered if I might yet venture to assume the slippers that peeped coyly from under the shabby sofa. I even allowed my thoughts to wander to the pipe that reposed in my coat pocket. Another minute, and I could turn down the surgery gas and shut the outer door. The fussy little clock gave a sort of preliminary cough or hiccup, as if it should say, "Ahem, ladies and gentlemen, I am about to strike." And at that moment, the bottle boy opened the door and, thrusting in his head, uttered the one word, "Gentlemen." Extreme economy of words is apt to result in ambiguity. But I understood. In Kennington Lane, the race of mere men and women appeared to be extinct. They were all gentlemen, unless they were ladies or children, even as the Liberian army was said to consist entirely of generals. Sweeps, laborers, milkmen, costermongers, all were impartially invested by the democratic bottle boy with the rank and title of armigeri. The present nobleman appeared to favor the aristocratic recreation of driving a cab or jobmaster's carriage, and as he entered the room, he touched his hat, closed the door somewhat carefully, and then without remark, handed me a note which bore the superscription, Dr. Stillbury. "You understand," I said, as I prepared to open the envelope, "that I am not Dr. Stillbury. He is away at present, and I am looking after his patients." "It doesn't signify," the man replied. "You'll do as well." On this, I opened the envelope and read the note, which was quite brief, and at first sight, in no way remarkable. "Dear sir," it ran, "would you kindly come and see a friend of mine who is staying with me? The bearer of this will give you further particulars and convey you to the house. Yours truly, H. Weiss." There was no address on the paper, and no date, and the writer was unknown to me. "This note," I said, "refers to some further particulars. What are they?" The messenger passed his hand over his hair, with a gesture of embarrassment. "It's a ridiculous affair," he said, with a contemptuous laugh. "If I had been Mr. Weiss, I wouldn't have had nothing to do with it. The sick gentleman, Mr. Graves, is one of them people what can't abear doctors. He's been ailing now for a week or two, but nothing would induce him to see a doctor. Mr. Weiss did everything he could to persuade him, but it was no go. He wouldn't. However, it seems Mr. Weiss threatened to send for a medical man on his own account because, you see, he was getting a bit nervous, and then Mr. Graves gave way. But only on one condition. He said the doctor was to come from a distance and was not to be told who he was or where he lived or anything about him, and he made Mr. Weiss promise to keep to that condition before he'd let him send. So Mr. Weiss promised, and of course, he's got to keep his word." "But," I said with a smile, "you've just told me his name, if his name really is Graves." "You can form your own opinion on that," said the coachman. "And," I added, "as to not being told where he lives, I can see that for myself. I'm not blind, you know." "We'll take the risk of what you see," the man replied. "The question is, will you take the job on?" "Yes, that was the question, and I considered it for some time before replying. We medical men are pretty familiar with the kind of person who can't abear doctors, and we like to have as little to do with him as possible. He is a thankless and unsatisfactory patient. Intercourse with him is unpleasant, he gives a great deal of trouble and responds badly to treatment. If this had been my own practice, I should have declined the case offhand. But it was not my practice. I was only a deputy. I could not lightly refuse work which would yield a profit to my principal, unpleasant though it might be. As I turned the matter over in my mind, I half unconsciously scrutinized my visitor, somewhat to his embarrassment, and I liked his appearance as little as I liked his mission. He kept his station near the door, where the light was dim, for the illumination was concentrated on the table and the patient's chair, but I could see that he had a somewhat sly, unprepossessing face and a greasy red mustache that seemed out of character with his rather perfunctory livery, though this was mere prejudice. He wore a wig, too, not that there was anything discreditable in that, and the thumbnail of the hand that held his hat bore disfiguring traces of some injury, which again, though unsightly, in no wise reflected on his moral character. Lastly, he watched me keenly with a mixture of anxiety and sly complacency that I found distinctly unpleasant. In a general way, he impressed me disagreeably. I did not like the look of him at all, but nevertheless I decided to undertake the case. "I suppose," I answered at length, "it is no affair of mine who the patient is or where he lives. But how do you propose to manage the business? Am I to be led to the house blindfolded, like the visitor to the bandit's cave?" The man grinned slightly and looked very decidedly relieved. "No, sir," he answered, "we ain't going to blindfold you. I've got a carriage outside. I don't think you'll see much out of that." "Very well," I rejoined, opening the door to let him out, I'll be with you in a minute. I suppose you can't give me any idea as to what is the matter with the patient. No, sir, I can't, he replied, and he went out to see to the carriage. I slipped into a bag an assortment of emergency drugs and a few diagnostic instruments, turned down the gas, and passed out through the surgery. The carriage was standing at the curb, guarded by the coachman, and watched with deep interest by the bottle boy. I viewed it with mingled curiosity and disfavor. It was a kind of large brougham, such as is used by some commercial travelers, the usual glass windows being replaced by wooden shutters intended to conceal the piles of sample boxes, and the doors capable of being locked from outside with a railway key. As I emerged from the house, the coachman unlocked the door and held it open. How long will the journey take? I asked, pausing with my foot on the step. The coachman considered a moment or two, and replied, It took me, I should say, nigh upon half an hour to get here. This was pleasant hearing. A half an hour each way, and a half an hour at the patient's house. At that rate it would be 10:30, before I was home again, and then it was quite probable that I should find some other untimely messenger waiting on the doorstep. With a muttered anathema on the unknown Mr. Graves and the unrestful life of a locum tenens, I stepped in.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.